All right, they say the devil's in the details, and that's what we're doing today. We're talking about the Autolite 2100 and 4100 and what goes to make those carburetors what they are. What I've got here on the table is a 4100 Autolite. We'll be talking about both this and the 2100 right after the break.
Restoration of a classic Ford is a journey of discovery. Let Autocrafters help you with yours. We offer quality parts for Falcon, Fairlane, F-Series, Galaxy, Maverick, and Pinto. Contact us today.
All right, the carburetor I'm showing you right now is ubiquitous if you have an early Ford with a two-barrel on it. They put those suckers on anything that didn't move away quick enough. It was their replacement for what they had been using before the mid-1950s. And it was a really rock-solid carburetor. And I know this because Ford continued to use this sucker all the way up into the mid-80s until they went to the CFI system, which was a fuel injection, which honestly kind of sucked. It wasn't great. It wasn't bad. It just was. They used this so much and in so many different places, they had 8 different venturi sizes on these two-barrel carburetors. And I'm going to list them off for you right now. I've got it down in the description below, but you'll also be able to find a chart for this stuff that I'm going to put up on our website. So here we go. They had a 0.98 venturi that was 190 CFM. They had a 1.01 at 245 CFM. They had a 1.02 at 240 CFM. They had a 1.08 at 287 CFM. They had a 1.14 at 300 CFM. They had a 1.21 at 351 CFM. They had a 1.23 at 356 CFM. And they had a 1.33 at 424 CFM. Suffice it to say, they had enough carburation to cover anything. And no, I don't know what all the different venturi sizes were for. I have to believe that some of these larger venturi sizes are probably for truck applications like F700 and above. I can't swear to that, but I'm going to say that may be it because they were still using these things on 429s and even possibly 460s on the 370s maybe. I'm not knowledgeable enough in that to be anything but an idiot, so if you have information and can say, hey, on your chart, that carburetor was strictly on a 370, fire it away. Let me know in the comments below. So you're probably thinking, with all those two barrels that are available, surely they must have had at least as many 4100s. And they didn't. Oddly enough, they only had 3. They had the 480 CFM 1.08 venturi. They had the 600 CFM 1.12 venturi. And then they had the Mammoth one at 669 CFM at 1.19. I'm going to break off here for a second and talk about that really big one because some of you guys may be perking up thinking, holy cow, got to get me one of those since you like this carburetor so much. And it's going to be tough because quite frankly, the 1.19 venturi carburetor is very, very rare because they only used it on one engine and that was the 383 Turnpike Cruiser in 1959. Never again did they use that carburetor. Everything after that was the 600 CFM 1.12 venturi size on pretty much everything, all the way up through 428s. They used that Autolite carburetor until they switched to the 4300s. And no, I'm not getting into that today. But if you want me to talk about the 4300 carburetors and what's available on those, I got to have like 8 people on that one because I'm not convinced everybody wants to know about the 4300. I only have one, and that's on our 72 Mach 1. I digress, like I'm wont to do. So, this carburetor, the 4100 is a really nice carb. It does have its share of small problems. One of those problems in my book is the fact that it is not a center float carburetor like you would have on a Holley. The floats are on one side of the carburetor, and that makes these carburetors tend to be really finicky about going into a corner, or if you hit a jostle like a speed bump off center, and it causes the vehicle to roll and slide like that, it will tend to want to make the carburetor puke a little bit, and it'll make it want to stumble. It was such a problem that on the performance cars in the later days, Ford went away from the Autolite 4100 and moved over to the Holley carburetors because of that center mount float. This carburetor right here will be awesome on anything up to probably a 351. We had one on our 69 Fairlane, and the reason I went away from it was the problem of my driving style, and this carburetor didn't mix because I like to go around corners pretty quick, even in that wagon I've got, and it would tend to want to overload the float and throw fuel in it and cause it to bog and stumble. I also got tired of these. These are kind of bad about a hard, hot soak problem where it'll puke the fuel down into the carburetor and cause the thing to be super rich on startup. And they will tend to percolate out of the vents here and throw up fuel all over the top of the carburetor. In milder climes than where we're at, because we're in South Carolina, I don't think this is a bad carburetor. I've got another one that I've just bought recently that we're gonna probably throw on something, maybe even Logan's Ranchero down the road. But from a performance aspect, unless I can find somebody who's really good at making these things sing in a performance vein, some of the issues I've run into with it on the wagon, it's not a great carburetor for that. Now I'm gonna talk about mileage. That's not a real big deal to most of us. If we have an old car, we're pretty much stuck with the idea that if we get 8 miles to the gallon, we're super happy about how the car's performing. But what I want to talk about is something that a good friend of mine brought up to me a long time ago. John Einert, who sadly passed away, ran Pony Carburetors for years and years, always talked about the fact that a 4100 Autolite is going to outperform a 2100 on gas mileage. And he explained it to me this way. No matter what two barrel you have, unless it's the small 240 CFM, you're going to be running, you know, a lot of CFM through there, especially if you get up into the 1.33 carburetor. That carburetor is like 425 CFM-ish. What John would say is if you take and put an Autolite 4100 on that car, then you have the 240 CFM two barrel with the addition of another set of barrels that you can kick in when you absolutely need them. If you can only stay on those two barrels in the front, your mileage is gonna be a ton better. Okay, not a ton better. It's gonna be better because you're talking about a carburetor that's, you know, attached to a C4 transmission who is not going to give you great gas mileage on the interstate. It's just the way things go. But that is one caveat on these carburetors. If you do the 4100, your mileage is gonna be better. If you do the 2100, your mileage is not gonna be as good, but you know, it's stock, you don't have to replace the intake manifold. That's the only real advantage I can see to the 2100. But that's just me. Do what you want. All right, now what I'm gonna talk a little bit about is the tag on the carburetor, if you are so lucky to have the tag on there. What I'm gonna do is do a little basic decode on the top number and then talk a little bit about the number below it. Now, we have a C4OFA on this tag. Now, the C is for 1960s. It would be a B if it was a 1950s 2100 or even a 4100. Then you have a 4, 1964. O is for Fairlane. Fortification has a really nice outline of this on their site. I'm gonna put a link below me here, and then I'm also going to put it in the description below so you can go direct clickety-click right to the link. And then F, which that is the parts division it comes from. This is general parts. If it was something else, it might have an E there. You'll see a lot of intakes with things like a C40E. That's not unusual for engine parts like that because it's an engine part. You would think this would be a C40E, but it is not. And then finally, this is probably the most important letter on here. This A at the end dictates that this is a manual shift carburetor. The reason I say that that's very important is because the 4100, if you have an automatic version of it, it's pretty mundane. People don't want to pay a lot of money for them. If you end up having a manual shift one, then they're worth a lot more money, especially in the 108 Venturi size, because those went on the 289 hypos and making them obviously a little bit rarer carburetor. Now the 119 one, obviously that's pretty much anything. But that's how you do it. Now, why they didn't do the A as automatic, I have no idea. It seems to me like that would make the most sense, but that's not what Ford did. All right, one other thing on this is if you don't have the tag on the carburetor, guess what? Ford gave you the basic information from the tag on the body of the carburetor, and that is down on the foot on the driver's side of the body. Now, keep in mind on the Autolites, that the body of the carburetor and the base plate are all one piece, so you don't have to worry about this all having been mismatched around. Also know that the information is pretty bare bones. You only have, a lot of times after 1965, the year designation, the body style designation, and the type of carburetor that it is. So in other words, where the tag will give you a lot of information comparatively, the actual base plate will only tell you bare bones what you have, that you have a 1966 carburetor with that six on there, You'll know that you have one for a Mustang with the Z, and then you'll also know that you have an automatic carburetor with that B designation at the very end. They lose the C for century, and they also lose the base part type, like say an F, which is what this would be for an Autolite 4100. So I've talked you into a 4100, right? You're gonna go out and do this carburetor and put it on your car. You're gonna get yourself an aftermarket intake manifold, and you're just gonna get better gas mileage, and you're gonna smile all the time. No. I hate to drag you down this path and say these things, but that is the one thing I will say about the 4100 that is absolutely maddening, is Ford had a special way they set these carburetors up. They used a 1-inch spacer typically with a PCV hole in the back of the spacer. And if you look, there is no provision for PCV on the back of this carburetor. Yay, team. And so that creates a problem with that. So you have to use the Ford style PCV spacer if you want to have PCV on your engine. And when you do that, well, guess what? It doesn't work with modern aftermarket intake manifolds, because what are they doing? They're taking as much aluminum out of those intake manifolds as they possibly can to save money. So there you go. You have a problem right there. Another issue on these carburetors is this, less of an issue now than it used to be, is the fact that these carburetors use a Ford jet after a certain date on the carburetors. Usually it's about the early 1960s, like 65 carburetors on back used a Holley style jet, 66 carburetors on up used the Ford style jet, so you may run into that. But Mike's Carburetors, places like that, have the jets available for the later Autolites. If when you take the jets out, I showed you this the other day on the rebuild on the two barrel, it'll have an F stamped in the side of the jet. If you have that, then you'll need to get the Ford jets for it if you want to play around with the jetting on the carburetor. The only other thing is I'll say is if you're wanting to do this and you want to put a manual shift Autolite on your car, like I said before, they were $289 hypo, and boy howdy, are those a lot more expensive. So much so that someone took this one, which is a 4100 that is for an automatic, and lopped off the automatic stuff on it. And I don't know anything about this carburetor. When I first picked it up, I thought maybe that it was a four barrel for a four speed, which would make it worth a lot more money. It's not. It's an Autolite that somebody's hacked, which makes me worry about the internals and the boosters and stuff being wrong, because they've done this. Lord only really knows what else they've done. So that's our show for the week. I know this is kind of a minutia thing, but I really wanted to go into it because I found it fascinating that Ford did what they did with the Autolite 2100, that sucker's been around, you know, since Ford's 1950s cars. It's just kind of crazy that they held onto it that long. Do me a favor, go and leave a comment in the section below. Tell me whether you like this video or not. If you like this kind of thing, if you like hearing the minutia, let me know about it. Also, subscribe to the channel. If you're not subscribed to the channel, you're not gonna ever know what we do unless you just happen to find us, you know, floating around in all the vitriol that is out there for YouTube. So subscribe to the channel, click the bell for notification, you'll see what we do. Also, check out our Patreon account at the $10 a month level. You get monthly meetings with me on Zoom. And that's not me just sitting there barfing information out at you. We are going back and forth and doing tech questions and things like that. I also am available other times for my patron guys to ask tech questions of. I prioritize those because those are the guys who are putting their money where their mouth is and supporting us on the show. So we are available to them a little bit more than we can be to other folks. Finally, like each other, love on each other, treat each other nice. We'll see you on down the road. I really wish this was a 119 because I could probably retire off of selling that carburetor. If I ever find one of those, I'm gonna do a video just to talk about how much money I made when I resold it, because this was a 1 year only carburetor. I don't even know who'd want it though. Is anybody still alive that would want that carburetor for a 383 that I didn't even know existed until like 2 days ago when I started doing the research on this? You would not believe how much research went into this just for like a 8-minute video.